Just mentioned that this is not a separate study, but this is something which as NHSRC we routinely do every year to basically track the amount of health expenditure that happens across the states in the country. And this particular thing is based on the RBI, Reserve Bank of India publishes the revenue and capital expenditure and budget of all the states. So based on that secondary data, this analysis has been done. Next is due next January. So basically this is 1 year old data, and therefore we will be talking about the budget up to 2008-09 and 09-10, not beyond that. Also, when we why we are speaking about this public health expenditure, we should also remember in background the context. And the context is, of course, we are talking of more and more investments in the health sector. But why it becomes important is, as we also had a discussion yesterday, the government sector in India is basically dependent or getting around 20% of the kitty. 80% is private expenditure. As we know in the health sector, in the GDP. So of this 20% that the government gets, it caters to around 40% of the inpatient care and 20% of the OPD. But in OPD, if we remember that almost half, as many studies suggest, goes to the informal sector. So that remains only 50, which goes to the formal sector. So in the formal sector, it is 20-30. So within the formal sector, government caters to around 40% of the OPD and also 40% of the inpatient care with 20% of the money. So in that context, let's look at what the government is doing in this decade and try to see if it makes sense and how it goes on. Well, this is very general. The background is basically there is a commitment from the government to increase the public health expenditure as 2-3% of the GDP. 3% is the target, which is hovering around 1% right now. But what is actually happening? Before we go into the exact numbers of how things increase, we just should remember that through the government, there are basically two routes of financing. The treasury route, which is very structured, as we can see, I will not go into the details because of lack of time. But then the society route, which has actually emerged especially after NRHM. And a whole lot of money, government money, is moving off budget, state and below, through the society route. Just a little bit of background that why the society route and why suddenly, and there is a lot of debate which is more beneficial and not. Why it was thought of a society route was basically there are certain limitations within the treasury route. Even if you provide more fund, it won't get absorbed, mainly because number one, there is line item budget, which means lack of flexibility. So even if you have unspent balance in certain lines, others where it is needed can't be moved around. Second is the doctrine of lapse. Almost 80% of the public health expenditure in the states is the revenue expenditure, which lapses by the 31st March. So you can't continue, means if you have started something, either you have to finish or forget about it. Then another major structural issue within the government budget is the DDOs, drawing and disbursing officers. Government expenditure cannot be done by everybody, only by designated officers as drawing and disbursing officers. Now most of the states within the health sector has DDOs only up to the block and not below that. And the DDO powers at the block is mostly limited to salaries, TADA, medical reimbursement, which means essential expenditure on, say, infrastructure, procurement, equipment, training happens only at the state and district level, which is far removed from where the need is. That is another point of inefficiency. And of course, within the government system, because of the accountability and the checks and balances, there is a separation between expenditure and authorization and payment. Expenditure is done by the DDO, whereas authorization and payment is done by the treasury officer. That delays things. So there becomes a limitation within the government budget how the funds can be absorbed. So a society route was mobilized. Actually, this is not new to NRHM, it existed much before that, and also Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan, a whole lot of funding has been going through like that. But within the society route, what we should also remember is, number one, this is off budget, especially when we are talking of the states. So the state health minister, or the state finance minister, doesn't really officially know what is coming and what is happening. Of course, they can ask for the society accounts, but then it's not part of the state health budget. So that kind of debate within the assembly doesn't, or it's difficult to happen. Secondly, in the society, it's the same point where expenditure is authorized and payment is made. So there are certain problems that might crop up, which essentially means there needs to be more accountability in terms of society becoming really functional with all the members present, a minimum quorum, the non-government members, and transparency in terms of concurrent audits and things being put on the public domain and all. So with that, let's see what happens. We actually see that Now we are talking of the not the real but the actual expenditure. So this is not adjusted to inflation, actual year on year whatever is the expenditure. Central government health budget can really be seen like suddenly pushing up 2005-06 onwards, which is coinciding with the NRHM coming in. When we talk of the states, again almost a similar pattern, and we can see that high focus states and the general states, this uptake or increase has been pretty high. Northeastern states as compared to other states doesn't seem so because the amount of money is low, but if we look at the percentage, it's also quite high. So post NRHM there has been more and more resources being put into the health sector. Now there had been certain issues and some papers had come out regarding substitution, that states might be substituting the central health budget. But when we look at those papers and the discussions, actually this is the point that they are referring, that it's not the actual amount which has decreased, but it seems that over last 1 or 2 years maybe the rate of increase of the state might be less than the central government. Central government increase more funds, states increase less. But this I think is a variation and we can only comment upon whether it is reducing or not only if it has a 3-year continuous trend. Otherwise it will be too premature to comment upon it. One thing that clearly comes out starkly is in this decade our GDP has been growing around say 7%, 8%. So overall health expenditure is almost keeping pace with that. But a clear distinction between pre and post NRHM phase. Pre-NRHM phase, all states put together, the growth rate in health expenditure within the government sector was just around 4%, less than the GDP growth rate. Whereas post-NRHM, it is 12% per year, annualized growth, which is more than the GDP. But because we had been growing less before NRHM, there is a whole lot of catching up to do. And that is why we see from 0.9, maybe 1.12% is where we are reaching. But then post-NRHM has really saw the shift. Also, this is not just the overall government expenditure, crucially for the capital expenditure. Capital expenditure annualized was growing only around 10% per year before NRHM, which is now growing more than 25% per year. So a whole lot of capital asset creation is happening in terms of building, in terms of equipment procurement, drugs and all. And this is really seen in terms of, forget about the top, which is basically the revenue budget, almost 80 to 90% of the revenue budget has always been absorbed. But when we are talking about absorption of capital budget, look around 2001-2, only around 40% of the capital budget could be absorbed by the states. 60% was unspent. This increased quite dramatically to 99%, 100%. Almost whatever the capital fund is coming, states are able to absorb it. It seems there has been certain increase in capacity, maybe various institutions that has come into being, which has resulted in this increased rate of absorption. Now that was the treasury budget. When we look at NRHM, of course that kind of increased fund flow is there. Nothing new, so I won't actually go into details of it. Both the RCH flexi pool as well as the NRHM flexi pool has been increasing. There has been a little drop in the NRHM flexi pool allocations because there has been a little carryover balance. So to equalize the carryover, expenditure has been increasing but little drop. And we can say this is a drop only if this continues for another year or two. But let's look at some of the issues, the problems. Now, we see that in terms of actual money put in by the central government, it is increasing quite a lot. Post NRHM, this increase has been more than the GDP. But there are certain bottlenecks, certain issues which has to be tackled. We just can't take this increased flow as guaranteed. Number one, when we are talking of NRHM and through society route, now almost 20 to 30% of the funds at the state level is coming through NRHM fund. And some states, now I hear that this year's PIP, the NRHM budget will be almost equal to the state health budget. So NRHM is slowly growing. But when it is growing, we also need to remember that like the treasury, there are certain problems with the NRHM route of funding also. Number one, NRHM, if we want to reconcile and submit a final account of how much the state has spent, there are so many levels. And for example, a state like Rajasthan will have to settle 33,000 bank accounts to produce one final account. That takes time. It can't happen within a month or a few weeks, which essentially means there will be a delay, because the moment there is a delay in submission of regulation certificates, the funds flow will be delayed like that. So that is a source of delay. Another is the annual committed grants like untied grants, AMG. These are kind of untied fund which moves around the facilities, villages and all. It's very difficult to keep it at what it is being spent on and why it is spent on a certain item or not. So accountability becomes a issue if we ask the state to account for this. Then civil works procurement, essentially the expenditure cycle is much more. Civil works takes around 2 to 4 years to complete the expenditure cycle. Procurement between states takes around 9 months to 1.5 years to complete the expenditure cycle, which essentially delays the things. So basically, as we see, there are more and more funds coming in, but still one thing we have to remember that we might still feel that this is inadequate, mainly because if we just look at the NCMH estimation, which was made in 2004, the amount of expenditure needed per capita to cover for basic, essential and secondary level healthcare was around 1,200 rupees per capita, against which presently the state governments are spending in the range of 200 rupees per capita, 200 to 300 rupees per capita is what they are spending. So what we need is actually not an increase of 20%, 50%, 60%, but 3 times, 4 times, 6 times increase. And that is why even after this increase, it seems quite inadequate. But that doesn't mean that there has not been an increase. But still, the major issue is why there are bottlenecks. Number one, high expenditure cycle, like civil works procurement, I just said, because of if it takes 4 years to complete an expenditure cycle, obviously it will pose a limit on how much funds can be absorbed. Then there is lack of preparation, especially when we look at trainings. A whole lot of training budget is unspent across the states, mainly because of lack of preparation in the sense that where the training will take place, where is the venue, where is the, what is the curriculum, who are the trainers. With the lack of preparation for this, the expenditure is not picking up. Then there are huge advances outstanding across various states. Almost 60% budget lies as advances at any point of time. That has to reduce quite a lot. Cash reserves, because of uncertainty in funds flow, almost 30 to 40% of the funds are tied up in bank as cash, not being spent. Then there are limits on financial decentralization. Now, if you give less and less power to the lowermost people, lowermost level, where decision is needed, then obviously absorption will be reduced, because higher we go, less we know where the problem is, so less we can spend. And penetration of banking and e-commerce. When we have banking and e-commerce penetrated through the, say, PSC level or below, funds can move easily and reconciliation can be done pretty quickly. If not, then it takes time. Yeah, so this is the last slide. So what is the way forward? First is a shift from line item budgeting to block budgeting or grants, which is somewhat made possible through NRHM. Creating two separate channels. One is for routine expenditure, which is expenditure cycle below a month, and other for high expenditure cycle like procurement and all. Then why can't we have purchasing of care just like private sector within the public health system? Why can't the government purchase care from the PSCs and CHS in terms of amount of money given? So that can, means wherever the load is more, more money goes. And some states like Rajasthan and MP has started small steps in this direction. Differential financing is a concept now agreed to. So we move funds where it is needed more. Kind of creating district health funds for flexible innovations and others. And shifting the focus of audits from compliance to guidelines, which is the main impediment, to transparency and accountability, so that it is left to the discretion of the facility in charge and not so much dependent on the guidelines. Thank you.